Hi, I'm Marge Easley with the League of Women Voters. The League is a nonpartisan organization that has provided voters with unbiased election information since 1920. We've invited candidates to talk with us so you can learn more about them. Joining us now is Dan Laschober, candidate for Oregon Representative District Number 26.
Hey, Marge. Nice to be here.
Nice to have you here. Dan, this is you ran for another office in 2016 for Senate.
I did, in somewhat quixotic or Don Quixote fashion. I ran for the U.S. Senate.
And you're back. You're back doing this, and you're running for the Republican primary against Representative Vile.
Right, Representative Vile's been in there for two sessions now. That's correct.
Okay. So tell us a little bit about yourself and why you decided to do this.
Sure. First off, I'm from Wilsonville. I've been there a couple decades now. I'm a husband of 34 years and a father of two children. I raised my children there in Wilsonville, and my wife is a secretary at the primary school.
Oh,
so we're well established in that community. Now, I moved to Wilsonville after living in Europe for 5 years. I spent 3 years in Canada before that with a large international manufacturing company working in finance professional roles. We chose Oregon because it was a place to raise our children. We thought, you know, the schools looked pretty good. The environment's great for kids. That's why we came back. I was raised in the West. I've lived in Washington, raised in Alaska, so I'm a product of the West, and Oregon is a nice fit for all those things. The reason I'm running, frankly, is because I don't think the current representative is doing the job I voted for him to do. So I'm running in opposition to a sitting Republican. I'm concerned about his votes on various issues, and we can tease those out as we go. But
yeah.
Generally speaking, I think the focus is wrong. I think we need to be more focused on the financial issues, the fiscal sanity, the educational outcomes, the infrastructure. I think we've gone too many other directions.
Okay. Well, let's touch on the fiscal part first.
Sure.
What changes would you make to Oregon's? Would you make any changes to our tax structure or to the way we finance all of the services that are needed in Oregon?
I think voters have clearly said they are not going to accept a sales tax. We've had that at the polls many times over and over. Now, it's fair to say, though, that if you go down a list of taxes the legislature passes, there's at least 20 of them that are clearly sales taxes, such as the Measure 101 was against the assessment on health insurance or health care premiums. That's a tax, okay? So I don't know that I'm going to win that battle if we're not going to go down the path of sales tax. So I'm not running in that sense other than we need fiscal discipline. So if you look at the budget in the last biennium that they passed, it went up 11%. Roughly 55% of that, I think, went toward PERS, an increase in PERS, and another maybe 15% went to an increase in benefits. And let's probably put the blame on healthcare benefits, if you will. We know those are rising at that rate.
Right.
So it's those combinations of things. We don't have a revenue problem. If it grows 10 or 11% every biennium, if it doubles every 10 years, you know, since I've been here, it's a huge increase. So that's not the issue to me.
Well, education takes a huge chunk
out
of the budget.
It sure does. Yep, absolutely. Rightly so.
Do you feel that education is getting its fair share, or do you feel it's being gobbled up by all the PERS obligations?
It's a timeless question. How much is enough? But I think, you know, when we compare to others around the country, we're in the middle somewhere when you add in all the money that goes, you know, per student in the classroom. But it's clear the classroom sizes are still a little big, especially at the younger ages. That's very difficult to teach those ages, you know, when they're not self-directed. I don't have all the answers. If I did for education, I would bottle it. But, you know, I've been around education all my life. My mother was a teacher. Again, my wife works at the school. The stories every single day, you know, I hear about what's going on in the school.
Well, I'm a former teacher, too, so
yeah.
I understand.
Right.
I wanted to know, there had been some changes suggested for PERS and some changes that were already made. Do you feel there's enough, or what more would you suggest?
Well, I think there are a lot of good answers out there. We certainly can't change the contract we've made with people. That's been adjudicated in the courts. That's clear. And I wouldn't push for that any further. But when you talk about going forward, the defined contribution approach is clearly a better answer. Now, private industry got to that answer 20, 30 years ago easily, because you make a contribution and it becomes then self-directed by the employee, managed by the investment group overall, selecting the right funds. But it relieves the employer of the future burden of not knowing how much we're going to owe.
Right.
It relieves some of the issues of spiking at the end of your time in the job. We need to cap what we pay. I think most of us, most everybody would agree on that. You know, paying out millions of dollars is not what that fund is intended for. It's intended to supplement your retirement. It's intended to be X percent of your last salary. So those are changes that most people can agree on. But the problem is getting it on the floor, getting the people to move it forward.
And I know infrastructure is another interest of yours. And we do have, we got some transportation funding. Do you feel that was sufficient? What more would you advocate for?
There's an awful lot of funding from the last session. That's mm-hmm. We're talking 2017,
right.
Two sessions ago, technically. The big funding bill for infrastructure and transportation, there's a lot in there that's going to have to be worked out still. So my main concern is that we don't end up with another Cover Oregon and we spend $300 million going nowhere. We spend $300 million on a bridge going nowhere and we waste that money. There's a lot of talk of tolling, right? That was part of the plan, but that's going to be very contentious. I don't really know how you could slow down the traffic anymore.
Do you have an opinion on the tolling?
It's not obvious where you would do it and how it would work and whether mm-hmm. federal law even allows it in the places where they're talking about it. So mm-hmm. the opinion is not yet formed, let's say, but it's not obvious there's a good answer there.
Okay.
It concerns me that we're moving ahead to a carbon tax. So
yes.
Right after we haven't even digested the transportation tax, an increase in gas prices at the first of this year and the next 3 years. And, part of it concerns me in the bill, the transportation bill that was passed, is we're going to do some social engineering in there, too. So I'm going to give you $2,500 if you buy an electric car starting this July. We've got to somehow figure out a way to make sure that money goes to the right places, not pet projects.
Okay. Cap and trade, or cap and invest, was talked about for the previous session.
Right.
And it probably will be one of the main topics.
It certainly will.
Coming up. Can you tell us your thoughts? How high is combating climate change on your priority list?
In terms of priority, I think of shorter term tactical things, right? So priority is a little bit longer term on climate change. So there's a lot in that. Let me talk about the transportation bill, the cap and trade they talked about, they mm-hmm. proposed. So I think they did the right thing. Senator Courtney, thank God for him sometimes, where the voice of reason.
Slow down.
That's right, slow down. Mm-hmm. Don't bring that to the floor. It's too early, it's too fast. There's no time for public input. They lasted 28 days this session. That was an outrageous thought process. Number two, it's a tax. Mm-hmm. Let's not kid ourselves, it's a tax. The money's going to be raised, and then we're going to trade credits, but it's still going to raise money. And the state's going to probably plop that into the general fund and carry on. Now, a problem with those taxes is they often start at say $15 per ton we're going to charge people, and that's going to be raise X millions of dollars. Next year it's going to be $30 a ton, and then it's going to be $50 a ton. And the estimate of what a good tax is about $80 or $100 a ton to actually suppress the use of these things. So I think it's going to have a big problem convincing the folks that it's going to solve the problem it intended to. Now on climate change, certainly I see the climate changing. I grew up in Juneau, Alaska. I literally grew up in the valley of a glacier that had been receding for 700 years. It's still receding. I see that. The climate's changing. The question is it catastrophic? Is it man-made? And can we do something about it in our little corner of the world? So I look at some of the ridiculous things, I'm sorry to say, that the legislature's done. So when they said, let's shut down one coal-generated electric facility, China is starting 500 coal-fired facilities in the decade. They've started a couple years ago. 500 coal-fired facilities. That's one every week for 10 years. And we're going to shut down one prematurely, pass the costs on to people, and the electricity we buy from other states, Idaho and elsewhere, is still going to be fired by coal power. So
okay.
We have an energy portfolio. We don't include hydroelectric in the energy portfolio because it's somehow not renewable. And the final word is this. An energy policy that wants to get at clean energy in this country would include nuclear power. And unfortunately, we're losing our ability to build that in this country. But as an ancient Chinese proverb would say, You know, the best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago. The next best time is now. But you're not going to get there with a 1% of solar and other uses today that we're trying to bring in. That's all that's powering in the world, 1% at the moment.
Well, unfortunately, we have run out of time, but it's been wonderful talking with you.
Thanks
you so much
me.
For
I
being here.
It.
Thank you.